Speaking with a leading double bassist in the world today, Leon Bosch, and if I were to read his Wikipedia page as an introduction, I would tell you that Leon Bosch is a double bassist known for his expressive bel canto style. But Leon, why don't you just introduce yourself briefly for the audience?
Liam, good morning. It's lovely to be speaking to you from 6,000 miles distant. How does one describe oneself? I mean, I think that's probably the most difficult question for any human being. But my life is complex and it'd be difficult to pin down any one thing. I'm a double bass player, I'm a conductor, I'm a publisher, I'm a writer, I'm a broadcaster, well, all sorts of things. Also, I have specialization in international relations, secret intelligence, and the list goes on. But I suppose what that highlights is that in essence, I'm a human being, and there are so many things that we do as human beings on this wonderful planet of ours. And if life is that special, we have to use it productively. And that's what I've set out to do with my life. Bel canto, of course, means beautiful sound in essence, and we associate beautiful sound with a voice, really. And this is the point about bel canto. Bel canto on the double bass originates in the music of Bottesini, who himself was an opera conductor and also one of the greatest bass virtuosos to have lived. And he has written a lot of fantasias on operatic themes for the double bass. So I suppose the bel canto question of my sound refers to the manner in which it emulates the human voice. And of course, this is the challenge for double bass players to play music based on operatic themes in the way that the voice would sing it.
Is that the case for all string instruments, or do you feel that way particularly for the double bass?
Oh, no, I think it applies to every string instrument. Look. String music or instrumental music arose out of vocal music, as you will no doubt know. And the objective was to emulate the human voice and also to underpin and to support the human voice. And of course, instrumental music as an independent pursuit came out of that. You know, the concerto grosso and earlier forms of instrumental music arose out of vocal music.
Which instrument to you closely depicts the human voice the most?
Of course, I started off as a cellist, and I think that the cello probably is the most accurate means of expressing the range and also I suppose, the underlying capability for emotional expression. I enjoyed playing the cello. It was something, well, I mean, I never was going to be a great cellist because I've been very poorly taught at the beginning. But the cello was something which I loved particularly. And I always enjoy hearing great cellists and also I was going to call it a record collection that tells you something about my age. Of course, my record collection has been replaced by a CD collection. But in my CD collection, I would imagine that most of the CDs, or a lot of them at least, are of cellists.
I see. And what do you think of the theremin? I've heard a lot of local musicians at least say that it's their personal preference, singers at least.
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I leave that to them to decide. I'm rather a little bit more traditional. I mean, the string families I know, just from the violin down to the double bass and, you know, keyboards. I will make an allowance for the harpsichord and the fortepiano, but beyond, and of course the piano itself, but beyond that, I've not really bothered to experiment too much. The music that we play, for example, I always try to relate this to human life. Music cannot be separated intellectually from our existence as a species. And I would imagine that everybody would agree with me that when it comes to transport, we're not necessarily going to revert to walking and to ignore the fact that we've made progress in how we get around. You will know that it's not that long ago in the United Kingdom, for example, where the footprint for the average human being was a maximum of 12 miles. That's the furthest anybody ever traveled from their home. Now, of course, to fly around the globe is easy. And, you know, even though we went into lockdown here officially from the 23rd of March, I looked at my Google travel record. And according to Google, I'd done, goodness knows, close to 10,000 miles already just in the very first part of the year. And I forget how many countries I visited during that time. And this, of course, is an expression of what has happened to us as a species, our development. And music itself, of course, also is not immune from this process of development. Most people think that the only way in which we develop is technically. But of course, emotionally, we grow also. And our means for expression gets ever more complicated. Not that it ever gets divorced from the fundamentals, you understand. you will know that there's been a particularly tragic period in our history in music, the 20th century, the latter part of the 20th century, where there was a concerted effort to divorce music from the fundamental elements of harmony and rhythm.
We're all suffering the consequences of that now.
Indeed. I mean, and it's much the same with everything in our lives. The 20th century, whilst it did provide us with great progress, also provided us with many problems. During lockdown, of course, what people realized is that the environmental damage can quickly be corrected. It didn't take very long for fish to return to rivers and for the birds to sing rather than to croak. And I guess music is not immune. My experience is that composers have begun to return to the essence of music. And the first thing is that music is fundamentally the expression of human life in sound. And once it's divorced from that expression, it ceases to be music. But composers have returned to this essence. Also the question of melody, the question of structure. Look, there was a time when young composers were encouraged, for example, to use an analogy for painting. If you think that pink's a beautiful color, of course it is, but you're not going to paint something entirely in pink. That, you know, the language is much more complex. So I'm encouraged about what is happening to music. I mean, I have a lot of new music written for me, and the quality of that music is quite exceptional. And it's a great responsibility, of course, to play all this wonderful music, but I do see a change in the kind of music that I'm being presented with. In 1984, or 83, I think it was, the very first piece ever written for me, I've not actually played it. I've not performed it. And I doubt whether I will ever record it, because it goes down a route which is not very comfortable, not for me as a human being, neither for the instrument. And I think that that composer has also changed course. And I've actually been in touch with him in the last 18 months or so, and I'm waiting for the revised version of his piece, which I asked him to have a look at again.
I won't ask you to name that composer, but that's fascinating. Your culture and experience in the world comes across when you speak. It's something that really stands out to me. And, you know, this obviously lends itself to your hardships and also just to your travels. On your website, you say, every note I play on the instrument embraces my life experiences, both in Europe and in my South African homeland. Could you tell us a little bit about, you know, your South African roots and how that differs to what you've experienced in the UK and particularly in the music scene?
A very complex question, and a journey of 58 years so far. In fact, I have my birthday, next birthday is in a month's time. But the one thing that I can tell you without fear of contradiction is that wherever you travel in life, the one thing that can never be cut away from you is your roots. And that I discovered very powerfully when I returned to South Africa for the first time after a long period in exile. I was sitting at a pavement cafe in Claremont in Cape Town, which you will know.
That's where I live, actually.
Well, it was in your home, in your neighborhood. Mm. I was sitting at a cafe outside with the sun beating down on my back, and I looked at the mountain. And actually, I was overwhelmed with a very warm feeling internally. And I realized that that was because feeling the sunshine, looking at the mountain, touched something very deep within me. My roots. At that point, I'd probably lived in the United Kingdom for over 20 years, but I was still fundamentally South African. On the other hand, I am an international citizen. It means that I can be comfortable anywhere in the world. I don't often have the language to communicate with my fellow human beings, but I can sense sentiment, and there are other ways of means of communication. Music, of course, has been central to that communication with the global audience. I know the countries where I feel instantly at home. I also know the countries where I have a little bit more difficulty feeling at home. Now, what has travel done to me? I think that we live in a time, as you know, with a lot of conflict and potential for even greater conflict. And a lot of this conflict arises out of ignorance and also a lack of understanding. And of course, there are only two things that can turn us into better citizens of the world. The one is education, and the second is travel. When you have traveled to a country and interacted with people in a particular country, they can never become your enemy. And this is some thing I worry about with South Africa. I mean, you will know that at the moment, big questions are being asked about our history as a global society. The question of racism has come up because of the murder of an American citizen. And what we have to understand is that we're all very much a part of the human race, and that those interests, there are those who, in whose interest it is to divide humanity and to set us against each other. What I can tell you also without a shadow of a doubt is that the view that we have of the world is not necessarily how it is. And what do I mean? I mean that very early on in our lives, we are given the official version of the truth. We are taught history, we're taught everything from textbooks. And you have to ask, who writes the textbooks? Whose agenda is it that we're being taught? And you must know that you cannot go from grade one to grade two until you've satisfied the authorities that you've learned the history they expect you to learn. You cannot pass from grade two to grade three until you've internalized the moral values and the system that they teach you. In music also, you know that the particular route that people are expected to travel. In Britain, we have this wonderful saying about, you know, that's not how we do things in Britain, or that's not the British way. And what it means is that you have to subordinate your human interest to the interest of the state and to the interest of the establishment. You have to. You must know also that you're not allowed to exist on this planet until you have a birth certificate. You're not dead till they've signed your death certificate. You cannot drive without a driver's license. You cannot drive your car without insurance. There are so many things that are prescribed to us about how we should live. Everybody apparently has to go out to work for a living. We've been suckered by the salary. And I think that that has undermined our capability for self-expression. You will probably know of Maslow's hierarchy. It is worth knowing that Maslow developed a framework for human existence, his hierarchy. So the first stage of that hierarchy was that we had to satisfy the basic needs of shelter and food. The second basic need that we had was to do useful work, so that whatever we did had meaning. The third stage of that the third level of that hierarchy was self-actualization, which of course means becoming the best human being you possibly can. And the final stage in the hierarchy, which is one which most human beings never get to because of the way in which we live, is transcendence. And music is very special in that it allows us this possibility to see what, or to feel, or to understand what transcendence possibly could be. To use a musical example of a piece, Mendelssohn, On Wings of Song. What does it talk about? It's a little miniature, but it's about music taking flight. You're off into the heavens. You experience things about the human soul that are not earthbound. And this is what makes music, to me, so very special. When I grew up in South Africa, I grew up in a society which was particularly brutal in the way it oppressed the majority of the population. And I was no exception to that oppression. And my entire life was built on resistance to that oppression, not on the basis of color, but of human values. Whatever is good for me as a human being should be good for everybody else in the world. Whatever I would like done to me should be good enough for everybody else. And music was for me an expression, means of expressing that resistance. All I ever needed to do was to play. Also, I began to realize that I could never be a status quo thinker. I had to question everything. Now, questioning, of course, is an interesting concept because most of society today questions in entirely an inappropriate manner without a true basis of understanding. I came across a very good description of this concept, and it's called the death of expertise. There's a man called Tom Nichols who wrote an article for The Federalist and also wrote a book about this concept. And essentially what he's saying is that we've misunderstood something fundamental, that knowledge is not exactly the same as wisdom. And whilst we might be drowning in information, we're lacking in wisdom, or the means to be able to make sense of all the information that we have at our disposal. Just think, with a mobile telephone, you can access the world's libraries, everything. This Isaac Asimov, of course, foresaw the internet when he talked about sitting in an armchair and having access to the world's libraries. And this is the truth of the matter. There's nothing that you cannot find out if you choose to. So there's no excuse for ignorance. I teach a lot of young people, as you know, and I sometimes use their own mobile phones to show them how sometimes they can be negligent in their own education. Not that long ago, I was teaching somebody a Bach suite. And of course, you have a prelude and you have an allemande, a courant, a saraband, and in the first two cello suites, you have bourrées and then a gigue. And I asked the student to tell me what an allemande was, and he couldn't. And I, of course, had to say, look, if you can't describe or define an allemande, how can you play one? And I said, give me your phone. And I just said, ask Google to tell us what an allemande was. And of course, you get a spoken reply. And suddenly, the performance of allemande improved. And I use just this music example to illustrate how easy it is actually to find out what you need to find out. In everything we do, we have to have an intellectual framework. Now, in South Africa, as you know, the intellectual framework, the moral framework, was faulty. And we still see the consequences of this framework. Also, we see that there's very little change in South Africa. And just because the complexion of the people who walk through the door of Parliament has changed does not mean that anything has changed. It is the systemic questions which have never been attended to. Power is vested in institutions. Individuals serve those institutions. And the truth of the matter is that the institutions have not changed. The army, the secret intelligence services, the central bank, all the other institutions of power were inherited unchanged. And there was seemingly no appetite to make any changes. And this is why I think that it is true that nothing has changed. In fact, things have got a lot worse. There are complaints from citizens. And I think sometimes it's easy to bark up the wrong tree. If we think that South Africa is a country blessed with riches, we have to ask who benefits from those riches and why. It's a country blessed with large gold reserve, diamonds, you name it, and the population, a young population, each with a pair of hands and an intellect that could be harnessed in the benefit of the society, not just South African society, but global society. And yet we cruelly abuse and waste that talent. I heard something very interesting from an Indian politician who, when criticized for not having a birth control policy in India and worrying about India being so poor and unable to feed such a large population, he said, well, actually, we don't look upon a larger population as having to have to feed more mouths. We look upon it as an extra pair of hands. And this is an interesting way to look to analyze the world. One of the books I'm reading at the moment is something called Geek Nation, and it's about how Indian science is changing the world. When we think about science, we always think of Silicon Valley, the United States, we think of Britain, and the world has changed dramatically during the last 50 years alone. You will know that India has a space program, and that you will also know that it is Indian computer scientists that helped to save the world from the potential catastrophe of the Y2K bug. I don't know if you remember that there was this fear that the entire system of computers would crash because they used only two digits to define the year. And that suddenly in the year 2000, things were going to be very difficult. And India was the only country that had enough skilled engineers to be able to deal with this, computer engineers. And now, of course, in the United Kingdom, I know also that every time I need to have something done to my mobile phone, the shop I go to, it will be Indian engineers. So there are dramatic changes taking place in the world without us knowing it. And I fear that South Africa, for example, is still very much stuck in the past. There's an analysis which is still based upon the idea that we're a little colony attached to the United Kingdom. But things have changed. And of course, it brings me very neatly to this question of my life in the United Kingdom. And I hope you don't mind me just continuing without you having the opportunity to say something.
Not at all. I mean, this is your time to shine, not mine.
When I escaped South Africa at the beginning of 1982, I had this overwhelming feeling that I was now escaping the oppression of racism and all that that meant. But it didn't take long for me to realize that actually, not a lot of change, that the United Kingdom wasn't this wonderful place where racism didn't exist. And I realized that actually, the United Kingdom had invented and exported racism, not just to South Africa, but globally. And I, of course, it is not as overt here as it has been and probably still is in South Africa. It is a little bit more eloquent and is a little bit more surreptitious, but it is quite vicious. It is not the person in the street who spits at you that you have to be, or calls you obscene names that you have to worry about. Here it is the gentleman in suits and ties. It is a fact supported by evidence that if your name on the CV sounds a little bit non-English, you're not likely to get an interview. If you live in a particular community with a particular postcode, your health outcomes will be poorer. If you're a doctor in the United Kingdom, the chances are that you will be earning less money than a counterpart that has a fairer skin. So Britain has terribly ingrained problems also. But as you know, in the light of what happened in the United States recently, the populations begin to examine these problems. During the COVID crisis, it turned out that, and they use this term BAME, B-A-M-E, Black, Asian, and Minority Ethnic people, were dying disproportionately to the rest of the population of the United Kingdom. And of course, it was easy for anybody to try to look for simple solutions. I'd heard so many people talk about the question of vitamin D, Black people just need sunshine. Very simplistic and also offensive. What they didn't wish to look at was the obvious. The elephant in the room was poverty. In the United Kingdom, like in South Africa, people of color still live lives of poverty. The other question that they didn't look at was that in the health service in the United Kingdom, it is people of color who disproportionately occupy the positions of the front line. So 44% of doctors in the United Kingdom are people of color. And for nurses and other medical staff, it's even higher. And this is never discussed. There's also the suspicion, not a suspicion anymore, but it's been proven that these people working in the health service did not have access to the necessary equipment to protect themselves from this virus. And that is why they were dying. And also they were placed in danger more disproportionately than their white colleagues. So Britain has a problem. And then to talk about the problems in the music business, of course I suffered racism and continue to suffer the effects of racism in my professional life. When I started in the music business, it was a very different environment. It was even worse than now. Wherever I went, I was always the only dark-skinned person in the orchestra. And colleagues who you think are civilized and educated people would sometimes say some of the most offensive things. I mean, I can tell you many individual stories about abuse that I suffered here, but the individual stories don't really matter that much, except I will tell you just two of these stories. I was still at music college in Manchester, but I'd begun to audition for doing extra work with orchestras. And I had done an audition for the BBC Philharmonic in Manchester. Friday afternoon at lunchtime, I had done this audition and I was put on the list by the principal double bass player of the orchestra. There was a panel that auditioned me. And that evening I went to a party, a social event at the house or the flat of a fellow student violinist. And at that party, for some reason, was somebody from the orchestra. And he happened to be a double bass player. And there was something about, I don't know what it was, but he was entirely hostile to me. And during the course of that party, he personally had gone to the bathroom, filled a bath of water, and tried to drown me in it. And as he was trying to drown me in this bath of water, he spouted a lot of abuse at me, racist abuse. But fortunately, I was rescued by the young woman violinist who then threw out this bass player. The other terrible incident, and of course, this is the sort of thing that you wouldn't expect happened to the United Kingdom, was when I went to perform in the festival in Swaledale, which is, you know, Yorkshire Moors, or North Yorkshire, near Richmond. The Swaledale Festival is a lovely chamber music festival, and I had driven to Swaledale and arrived early, and I stopped my car and had some lunch, and then I went to the guest house where I was meant to be staying. And driving to the guest house down a little narrow path, it was a guest house in a kind of small holding farm, a Jeep drove up behind me, and a man leapt out and he started racially abusing me. And it turned out this was a police officer. And of course, I was pretty upset by this incident. And I felt that I was going to go home and abandon my participation in the festival, but I was persuaded to stay. And when I made my complaint to the police eventually, because the festival didn't, things got worse. The police officer at the desk told me that they weren't going to register a complaint because apparently they don't have problems with ethnic minorities in Yorkshire. And I wrote a letter of complaint to the chief superintendent of the police force in Yorkshire. And bless him, he rang me, said that he'd read my letter, which had got to his desk that morning, and he was horrified by what he read. And he asked me whether I'd be home the next day, and I said yes. And he drove from Yorkshire to my house to come and apologise personally on behalf of the police force. And then he also told me that he didn't think that legal action against that police officer was necessarily the best way to go, but that he would develop a programme for this officer to be dealt with, and also that he would require this officer to issue a written apology to me. And that he hoped that I wouldn't be dissuaded from coming to play in the Swaledale Festival ever again. So I just tell you these two little stories to give you an indication of the problems of racism globally. It is not just South Africa that has this terrible legacy, which it seems unwilling or incapable of shaking. It is everywhere.
No, of course not. I mean, it just fills me with such despair to hear those two tales, and I'm sure that they're two of many. And you've said before that you've known love and comradeship, but also witnessed the epitome of hatred.
Yes.
You've said, "I've felt both shining optimism and deep despair. I've benefited from the pleasures of civilized society, but also seen the destructive impact of poverty and ignorance." Would you say that you were pleased with that head of police's solution to the problem that you faced that day?
As a human being, he was a decent human being. And his actions also spoke volumes, that he was willing as an individual to act when he felt that something was totally unacceptable. Now, the truth of the matter is, when he offered that solution, which he called local resolution, I told him that I wanted to think about it. And he said he would come back a few hours later. And I felt that given that he had made such an enormous effort to try to resolve this question, I would accede to his request of local resolution. And he fulfilled that promise effectively. But I look back and I think to myself that this kind of behavior from police officers and from others continues. And maybe if there were real consequences rather than just the question of being expected to go for diversity training to write an apology, it might change behavior much more quickly. You will know that, who was it who wrote the wonderful book, Malcolm Gladwell, talks about, I think it was Malcolm Gladwell, when you legislate for something, it happens very quickly. And as soon as you legislated, there's nobody that will agree that they did what was wrong before. For example, in South Africa, could you find anybody today that will admit to having been a staunch supporter of the National Party and of the apartheid system? And the answer is no. But of course, we know that they still exist. And we also know that perhaps they haven't changed their minds, but they dare not display it publicly because legally it is, well, it's illegal. But of course, you know that behavior like that sometimes is expressed when they think they, when individuals feel they can get away with it, and also they feel that the institutions will support them. In the United States, for example, officers still behave in this vindictive and violent manner because they know that prosecution is rare. South Africa, I mean, I worry about South Africa. I visit South Africa from time to time, as you know, and young people that have grown up since the end of the apartheid system have internalized the patterns of behavior and the frameworks of analysis that their parents thought natural during the apartheid era. And just to give you one little example, it's a few years ago now, but I went to give a masterclass at the University of Cape Town. My wife drove the car and she dropped me off at the university and she went to do whatever she was going to do and was going to fetch me at the end of the class. But she was late. And I sat on the steps outside the South African College of Music. And a young white South African student came up to me and in a very abrupt manner asked me for the keys to the room, be it whatever it was. And I, of course, had to say, look, I'm sorry, I don't, you probably think I'm the janitor, but I'm not. You need to ask for the keys of the desk. But the automatic assumption was that anybody with a dark skin in anywhere near the music college would have to be the janitor or a member of the estate staff. So that is troubling. I also have experience of, for example, going to a restaurant and then being asked by white South African to show them to their table. It's not possible for me also to be a guest in the restaurant. To go shopping in Pick n Pay and to be asked to by somebody to take their shopping to their car. This is an affront. And it means that South Africans haven't really begun to enter a new reality where every human being is accorded dignity and the right to exist alongside other human beings. In the United Kingdom, my journey has been, well, also in South Africa, I have to say, it's actually been a fabulous journey. I've been very blessed. And I've been blessed because I've encountered so many wonderful people throughout my life. And I could go through everybody from primary school onwards, but I will name just a few particularly noteworthy individuals. My cello teacher, Edna Elphick, British woman who came to South Africa to work in, of course, what was a colony, an ex-colony. But she had studied the cello with Pablo Casals, and she took me on as a cello student, and she began to make a big difference to my musical life. She introduced me to the Bach cello suite, she told me about Casals, and as a result, I bought some books about Casals, and her joys and sorrows, and I began to realize that there was this incredible world of music. Also, I started my career in music college as a cellist, and she taught me for my first year as a cellist at the South African College of Music. And then, of course, I ran into Zoltan Kovacs, and that was the man that changed my life completely. He was a great teacher, he was a great bass player, a great human being, and he taught me to play the bass incredibly well. It took him 1 year only to give me the fundamentals, which have been the foundation of my entire life. My second bass teacher, Max Runger. Max was German, and he had a completely different personality and character. And he encouraged me to experiment with everything in life. So I had Zoltan, the discipline from Zoltan, and also the thirst for experimentation from Max.
Would you mind taking us through your average lesson with each of them so that we can just appreciate the difference between the two?
Sure. I mean, with Zoltan, let's say you had a book of 30 etudes, and I did. I remember Sim Mandel's 30 etudes. Every week, you had to play one of them from memory. And then you had a piece that you were working on. And, of course, the first stage in learning that piece was memorizing it completely and utterly. Zoltan believed that if you didn't memorize, if you couldn't play from memory, you hadn't really learned it. So I'd walk through the door every for Zoltan's lesson, and he would ask me, Leon, have you practiced? And of course, I'd say yes. And I discovered early on that, you know, when you said you practiced meant you should be able to do everything. I was thrown out of a lesson once. Well, not thrown out. He just showed me the door and said, look, come back when you've done some proper work. And his standards were incredibly high. And I always, throughout my life, I still think, would that, when I perform, would that be good enough for Zoltan? Zoltan understood the essence of music. He understood the value, what it meant to work hard, dedication. Also, trust. He trusted me. He took me to the Cape Town Orchestra as a young kid to play. I sat next to him for rehearsals, and then for the concert, I'd sit at the back desk. He trusted me, and because he trusted me, I always had to rise to that challenge. Max was completely different. first piece of Bottesini I played for Max, he said, that's great. And he opened the cupboard and he just took out a pile of music and said, have a go at all of that. he gave me the opportunity to just to do what I liked, and he would guide me. Do you know, I have a recital in September here in Cheltenham, and the last piece on the program will be Schubert's Arpeggione Sonata. And I'm using Max's copy of that music. And I know that, you know, Max has been long dead, but I know that Max would be very proud to know that I still use his copy of the Arpeggione Sonata. I don't know whether he ever played that sonata, but he gave it to me because he wanted me to play it. And that was Max. I remember Max with great affection, as I do Zoltan. And it is interesting because I've recently established contact with Max's son, who lives in London. And Max's son is in the finance business. But it is so nice to be in touch. In fact, he reached out to me. He met me on Facebook, or he saw me on Facebook, and he wrote to me to say that his father always spoke about me, his double bass student. So I've been talking to Max's son, and it's a delight to be in touch with Max through his son.
So touching. Just backtracking onto the topic of the abuse that you received, I think what strikes me as so ironic is that usually the people who have received such abuse are so humane and just. So that's really something to think on. You know, when I speak to you, I just feel this warm soul who is kind by nature. Would you say that your hardships have affected you as a musician, the way that you express yourself in concert?
Of course. I mean, there's no doubt about that. Look, the question also of how does one deal with abuse, and how does one deal with a system which is fundamentally skewed against you? In my early years, I resisted in a much more visceral manner. But I soon realized that bashing your head against a brick wall wasn't always the most productive way to go. Also, dealing with individual people. Often when somebody is being terribly unkind, they are suffering and they have to take it on somebody else. You know, this question of kicking the dog. White South Africa was always adept at kicking the dog, and it would dehumanize everybody else around themselves in order to make themselves feel better. And the truth of the matter was, I began to realize that when people behave in this manner, one has to be kind to them. And also you have to help them to become better human beings. So I've found different strategies. For example, when I first began to travel a lot around the world, every time I came back into the United Kingdom, I'd be singled out at immigration. And I would always ask awkward questions. Why did they do this? Blah, blah, blah. And you have to edit that bit out. The blah, blah, blah is so South African.
But yeah, that's fine, don't worry.
But I would always ask awkward questions. I'd always be angry about the fact that I'd been singled out at immigration. I knew it was because of my color, and I got angry about it, and I'd ask awkward questions. But then I realized that actually nothing was going to change the behavior of that individual immigration officer. Part of the reason they took the job probably was because they wanted to be hostile to dark people or wanted to be difficult. I always warned my colleagues in the academy that whenever we went to arrived at an airport in Europe, especially, that they shouldn't be behind me in the queue because they'd wait forever. It's a fact that when you travel with a dark skin, you always have a miserable time at immigration in most countries. Even traveling with a British passport, as I do now, sometimes I will be stopped when there's no need for my passport to be checked. Driving through France, for example, with the academy on a coach, crossing a border, immigration officer steps up to the front door, has a quick look, and he's about to leave the bus, but then he sees me sitting there, and then he will walk all the way to me and say, excuse me, can I see your passport? And that's done for no other reason than for the fact that I have dark skin. And my colleagues, of course, are horrified because they've seen this at work so many times. The other thing which is important is that if we're going to be a kinder, gentler society, when we see injustice, we have to speak up. You know that I teach a lot of young South Africans. For me, it is an important thing to do because I see so many young people in South Africa that have committed no other crime than to be born into poverty. And because of that poverty, their life chances are diminished. They remind me of myself as a youngster. I grew up in the townships. Little money. I had enlightened parents and parents that were determined that education should be the route out of that misery. They gave us everything they had, and very much to their own detriment, at their own expense. They bought a piano. They bought a hi-fi system. I don't know whether you even know what a hi-fi system is, but it was the old way of playing music, two speakers, the turntable.
I do, actually.
Yes. And they paid for music lessons. They took us to the theater. They took us to concerts. They made enormous sacrifices. And I have to return this to the country of my birth. Young people, everybody needs somebody that believes in them. When you teach, it's not just a question of the lesson and taking £100 or dollars at the end of the lesson and finishing exactly it when the hour's up. One has a commitment to somebody's life. You know, sometimes I get very worried about my commitment as a pedagogue, as a teacher. Somebody will tell you something about something you said to them 10 years ago, and they will tell you how it transformed their lives. And it makes me realize that one has to be so careful with the words you use, especially with young people. It can either propel them positively in life, or it can undermine them forever. I know, for example, people in my life who will tell you about an incident when they were a child or at school, about something derogatory that was said to them. And you realize that it's hurt them throughout life. So it's important as a teacher, as a pedagogue, to know that one has a responsibility for somebody's life. It's not just about teaching them to play an instrument. You have a responsibility to give them a framework for life, a philosophy, something to believe in. Because if you don't believe in something, you're going to fall for everything.
I couldn't agree with you more. A great teacher of mine once said, it doesn't matter how good you or anyone thinks you are in this industry. All that matters is who taught you. Would you agree with that statement?
Yes. I mean, in my own life, I look back and I see all these wonderful individuals with whom I was lucky to have human interaction. And I know that they influenced me in a very positive way. And without them, I wouldn't be who I am. Look, the other important thing to say is this. Success in Western culture is individual achievement. And we really have to disabuse ourselves of that way of seeing the world. We are who we are, and we become who we become because of our connection to others, to our society, to our country, to the world. Everything I've achieved in my life has not been because of my personal efforts alone. It has been because of my connection to fellow human beings. It has been able to benefit from their wisdom. People have guided me. They've not necessarily told me what to do, but they've shown me possibilities in life. And I value that and I respect that. And I realize also it is possible to live one's entire life without thanking those people in a meaningful way. One of the people that I failed to thank properly in my life is Eleanor Warren. She was the head of strings at the Royal Northern College of Music in Manchester, where I was a student. She'd previously been a cellist. She'd also studied with Casals, and she'd been a BBC producer, but then she was head of strings. And I was one of her favorite students. Where she knew that I was short of money, and whenever there were scholarship auditions, she would tell me about them, and she would say, I'm on the panel for that one. It didn't mean that she was going to give me the money, but I knew that it meant that if I played well, I had a fair chance of being able to feed myself after that. She was a champion, my champion. She recommended me to the Philharmonia to perform a concerto after I had done an audition for one of their scholarship funds. That was my London debut concert. Thank you to Eleanor. And many years later, I thought about her and I thought that I wanted to find where she was. I eventually traced her an address in London, and I found a telephone number. And when I eventually got around to calling that number, she passed away. And I realized that it was possible to miss the boat. I had to make sure that I went around to thank everybody that had made my life what it is today. So you will know that I recorded, for example, a CD called The Hungarian Double Bass. That disc is to honor Zoltán Kovács. He changed my musical fortunes by teaching me as well as he did. There's a disc called The British Double Bass. That is to thank Rodney Slatford, who was my first teacher when I came to the United Kingdom. He has a publishing company, York Edition. I bought a lot of his music whilst I was a student in South Africa, and these parcels arrived with Emil stickers from London. And it was really wonderful to be able to study with Rodney when I came to this country. He also helped me with my first commission. I'd won a competition, and part of the prize was money to commission a new work. I had no idea how the process worked, and he helped me. He introduced me to John McCabe, who wrote me a wonderful piece, Pueblo for Unaccompanied Double Bass, and that piece is on that disc, The British Double Bass. Alan Stevenson, again, an incredible man. You know Alan Stevenson, South African composer. British-born, but honorary South African. Alan Stevenson conducted the university orchestra when I was a student there. He taught me the essence of how to play in a chamber orchestra, in a symphony orchestra. He provided me with opportunities to play, to learn and to play in public orchestral solos. He conducted for me a performance of Dedisdorf Bass Concerto, the first time I played a concerto with a chamber orchestra. He wrote for me a concerto, as you know, which I recorded, and that I think was played on FMR radio on Alan's 70th birthday. But the burlesque on that disc was written for Zoltan, my teacher. So I recorded this disc in a way to thank both of them, but especially for Alan, who had such a critical influence in my capability as an orchestral musician. Alan is a guru, and I thank him for his contribution to my journey. There was Sir John Mandel, South African born also, who was head of the Royal Northern College of Music in Manchester. He helped me from a distance. Sometimes beautiful things would happen in my life and I thought it's because I'd worked hard. But I began to discover that actually he might have paved the way for me, facilitated things at a distance. And this is the truth of the matter, that it is your network in life. It is the people that you encounter who make your fortunes or who shape your life. Of course, one has to work terribly hard, and I learned that very early on. Whilst I was studying with Zoltan, practicing 8 hours a day was nothing. I enjoyed it. I loved it. I still love it today. During lockdown, I've been getting up sometimes at 6 o'clock in the morning, sometimes early, and sometimes at 7. This morning, I started at 10 to 7. But I've already done my, could be my day's practice, or I might find time to do some more. But I've practiced Dragonetti, 12 waltzes, unaccompanied bass. I've never learned them properly. And during lockdown, I have the time to do this. I've worked on a piece by Pedro Valls, a Catalan composer and double bass player. A humoresque, which has not seen the light of day. I've had this manuscript with me for a long time, and I finally unraveled it because it's a mess. He wrote the introduction at the end of 3 pieces of paper and the, you know, everything's a mess. But I've worked out how it works. That's done. I have an online concert, another online concert broadcasting from my home for the African music series. On the 24th of June, I will play a piece by Alan Stevenson, which is for unaccompanied double bass. It's called Some Thought an African Being. And then one or two other pieces from my new CD, the South African Double Bass, which will be released very soon. And I'm also working, as I said, on the Sonata recital program with Max's copy of the Arpeggione Sonata. And at the same time, I've also decided to continue my education. In music, the thing that is absent from most people's portfolio of understanding is the financial question. How many human beings on the planet have good financial education? And the truth of the matter is that most of us are deficient in financial education. And this is why we have a very small financial elite in the world. South Africa is much the same. The financial elite is very small. It is because most people have never had good financial education. So I've done an open university course online in finance. And of course, I'm happy to be able to tell you that I understand the market and commodities and everything else far better than I ever did. I understand banking better than I ever did. And it's important to know that fractional reserve banking is at the root of problems, not just in the global economy, but in South Africa in particular. In South Africa, South Africans have to understand that the central bank is not owned by the state. It's a private corporation. And we have to understand that central banks are law unto themselves. They print money. They dictate the affairs of nation states. You will also know that South Africa's gold is not really owned by South Africa. it is traded on international markets and everybody else has control over those assets. And South Africa, of course, has slipped in the rankings of gold-producing countries, as you know. And this is because it is no longer possible for South Africa just to use slave labor to produce the gold cheaply. Actually, you have to pay people to go to work. And of course, South Africa is having to rethink what it does and how it's done it. Something I find troubling, I mean, as I told you, I visit South Africa quite often, and also I've made quite an investment in South Africa. For the first time in my life, I own a property in South Africa. I have something I could call my home. I've never had that. So I've always felt landless and stateless because I never had a stake in the country of my birth. But I decided that the time had come finally to have somewhere that I could call home. And that changes my relationship with South Africa very much.
When will you be visiting?
I was meant to be in South Africa during May. Most of May I was going to be, as an individual, conducting, teaching, and I was going to travel to Zambia during that time. Then also I was going to play with the Ubuntu Ensemble, which is an ensemble that I run. And I don't know if you know much about the Ubuntu Ensemble, but the Ubuntu Ensemble is comprised of South African musicians that live in the United Kingdom and also in other parts of Europe. And why did I call it the Ubuntu Ensemble? It's because of, you know, the concept I talked about earlier, that success is not an individual accomplishment. It arises out of our connection to others. This is the fundamental philosophy, Ubuntu, which I think everybody should internalize and not just be able to define it or write it down, but to live it. We have within our grasp that solution, and that should tell us what it is we need to do to progress.
Your life in particular seems to me the perfect kind of testimony of the destruction of negative behavior, like what you have described in the stories that you've told us, and also the beautiful uplifting power of good relationships and good foundation. And we spoke a little bit about how, you know, our hardships do tend to define us, but those hardships can easily be provided by people who care, people who can make you work to achieve your dreams and your goals. They don't have to be provided by evil.
No.
I think you're a brilliant testament to that. And anyone listening now should really think on everything that's happened to them in their lives and how their behavior can, in fact, affect those around them. And as somebody who experienced difficulties of my own in school, it did change the way that I am as a human being. It changed the way that I express myself, and you know, it did turn me into who I am today. But at the same time, there are other ways to get there.
Absolutely.
And I wouldn't wish that upon anyone. And I think if I can even in the slightest understand what you've been through, it's through that. And I in no way claim to have experienced the same type of hardship, but honestly and truly, just breaks my heart, the state of the world that we're in right now. I look into my own heart and, you know, I look to my faith for answers. And I just have to ask you, what are your spiritual beliefs? As somebody who seems to have all the intellectual answers in the world, as somebody who studied intelligence and international relations, where does it end for you? What is your spiritual belief?
Well, I mean, if you're asking the question about my former religious affiliations, I have none. And I will tell you how I arrived at this position. I went to a primary school, which was a Catholic school. Holy Trinity School in Matroosfontein, a township school. And I saw Catholicism at work. I saw religion at work. And I started school when I was five. And even at the age of five, I began to see through it. I realized that religion wasn't for me and that I could not subscribe to this philosophy. There was this idea, of course, also that your life was miserable, but that's fine, because if you believe in God, when you go to heaven, you will have all the things you never had, the education you never had, the home to live in, the food to eat. And I thought that philosophy was bankrupt. And I rejected religion completely and utterly by the age of six. I know that sounds crazy, but I just felt that it was an irrational means of control and also postponing our inevitable interaction with human life. So what is it that underpins my worldview? It is based upon fundamental principles of our common humanity. As human beings, we all have the sovereign right to be able to live decent lives, lives of abundance. And when I mean abundance, what do I mean? I mean fulfilling the four stages or levels of Maslow's hierarchy, to have food and shelter, to do meaningful work, to have the possibility to, for the fullest expression of one's humanity, self-actualization, and also to be able to experience transcendence. And how does one achieve that? We cannot achieve it with the current political organization of the planet. And what do I mean? We're divided into antagonistic nation states, where the success of one state is always at the expense of another. The zero-sum game. If person A is winning, then person B is losing. And of course, this is not fundamentally how we are as a species. I'm reminded of the first time I drove through Namibia, for example. I realized that the Herero people had practiced what is now fashionable in the West, something called sustainable farming. They did it for over 73,000 years. And now we wish to teach them how to farm sustainably. This is irrational. The world has existed for a long time. We have also had successful human organizations and social structures, which we've destroyed. And we need to return to what I call, and there's a book written about this by a man called Rushkoff, Team Human. What are the values that we need to reestablish contact with in order that we might prosper as a human society? Even with music, and I will touch on something which you probably want to talk about, but commercial music. As you know, I've done a lot of commercial music in my life. I've done probably in the vicinity of 7,500 pop tracks and film scores. And the way in which this music is done is incredibly mechanical. There was a time when film composers used to look at the film and write the music to fit the film. And now it's done in a much more mechanical manner. You have a number of frames that have to fit in a specified amount of time, so you record the music with a click track. It is devoid of any humanity. To be able to phrase is impossible, so you have to phrase with a click track. So you sit in the studio with headphones and the click track pumping out, and that's what you have to do. So in everything that we do, we've been taken away, we are removing the element of humanity. We are trying to achieve a level of abstract perfection. And of course, that demeans us all. It is the little imperfections that make the difference. No two human beings are alike. Of course, we share genetic material, I don't know, 99 point something percent, but we have our differences because of the way we socialized, of our personal experience, of our personal outlook, our personal calculations as human beings. So what I am dedicated to is to helping human society find a way to express this beautiful thing that we call life. Also, we have to have a perspective, a proper perspective, a realistic perspective. There are those who say that if anybody believes in intelligent life elsewhere in the universe, that they believe in little green men. Now, we have to take this a stage further in terms of logic. If it is true, as they say, that there's no other life anywhere else in this vast universe, then we have a great responsibility to this very special thing. And how can we possibly be living in the way that we do? How can we possibly be destroying this very precious planet with this little fragile atmosphere? How can we possibly be setting ourselves one country versus the other? How can we possibly be wishing to be hurtling towards nuclear war, major confrontation? How can we possibly practice racism? How can we possibly be abusive to each other? How can we possibly indulge in criminal activity? And when I talk about criminal activity, I don't necessarily mean petty thievery. I mean crime, big-scale crime, large-scale crime. In the United Kingdom, for example, during this lockdown, whilst we're all at home, great financial fraud is being perpetrated. We think that the state is being generous, paying us to stay at home. We think the state is being generous by paying the wages of the slaves of the corporation. But what in fact is happening is that money is being printed as it's going out of fashion. And when the whole thing is over, it is we, the population, who will be saddled with that debt. The corporations are being bailed out to the tune of billions, and they will walk away. You know, probably from following the news, that even companies that are availing themselves of this bailout are already firing people, thousands of them. In the United States also, you know, that 40 million people have filed for unemployment benefits. And these corporations in the United States have already taken trillions from the taxpayers' purse. So to tie these things together, you know, good financial education, good education at all levels, intellectual, spiritual, everything. That is what we need to do to human society to be able to prosper. And the question we have to ask ourselves is very simple. If this life is so special, would we like it to be here in 1,000 years' time, 10,000 years, 20,000? Would we still like to exist as a species? And if we do, we have to ask, is what we're doing now going to enable us still to be here in that amount of time? And the answer is obviously no. So we have to ask ourselves, what do we need to do individually and collectively to enable us to exist for another 1,000 years, another 10,000 years, 50,000 years?
Certainly not. And it's interesting that you make all of those points. You know, for me, what I feel is that there is a compassionate and loving force guiding us through this life, but there's also an equal and opposite force that facilitates the choices that we make along the way, that facilitates the learning that we undergo. And as somebody who really is open to exploring all, I would urge you to re-explore what you kind of ruled out when you were 6 years old. You may find that exploring it on your own and in your own ways may give you different insights into what it has to offer. But that's really all that I'll say on that. Our time has come to a close at this point, but yeah. I'd like to just tone things down a little by reading you a couple of points that I found on an article on CBC Music called 10 Things You Should Never Say to a Double Bassist. And I don't know if you've read the article, but
yes.
The first point was, don't you wish you played the flute?
Yes. If I'd been given a pound for every time somebody told me that, I'd be very rich.
You know, I was wondering how many of these are actually common. So, can rate them from common to uncommon. So number two is, let's see those hands.
Again, absolutely true. But, you know, it's important to know here that as a double bass player, the common misconception is that you need large hands to play the bass. And it's a bit like with everything else. It is the intellectual application of whatever resources you have that is the most important thing. How do you apply your physical resources to the task in hand? And just to give you a little analogy, I was in Australia or somewhere, and the England cricket team were playing the Indian cricket team. Mm-hmm. And they were all in a bar that evening, and the English players were towering hulks of men, strapping young men with, you know, very muscular, and goodness gracious, they were real fine specimens. And the Indian players were generally much smaller and very scrawny, physically unprepossessing. And somebody said to me, goodness gracious, just look at them, he said. Wouldn't you have thought that it'd be the English that'd be winning? And they weren't. And he said, you know, I think it's because the Indians have a better intellectual muscle. And that is the truth of the matter, that, you know, it's the application of the resources available to you to fulfill the task at hand.
Mm. Absolutely. Number three was, you're really keeping up with the band back there.
Yeah. Well, look, wow. It says something, but I've heard that also, but it betrays a kind of, I don't know, maybe it's witty. I don't know. Yes. I'll leave that one.
Perhaps that's left for jazz bassists. Number exactly. Four is, can you play the Seinfeld theme?
Of course, you get that all the time also. There are many more jokes along those lines, and some of them less savory than that particular one.
Such as?
Oh, no, I couldn't possibly say.
I see. The next one is, that thing is bigger than you.
Yes. Do you know, the first time that came up in a particular way was whilst I was a student at university. And I was told the story, and I'm sorry, I just need to tell you this.
That's fine.
Because it's important. I don't know if anybody in South Africa will remember Nefa van der Scaife, but Nefa van der Scaife was an incredible guitarist. He was a man of color. And he taught at the University of Cape Town. And he was, again, a guru. Whenever things were tough at the University of Cape Town in terms of racist abuse by members of staff who made you feel inadequate or just abused because it made them feel better, one could go to Nefa's room and talk to him, and he would heal the wounds. He was a wonderful man. But he tells me a story about one of my first exams at the University of Cape Town. He said that he was on the panel for the strings And they thought they'd finished for the day. But then someone said, oh, there's still some name at the end of the list. And that was me. And he tells me the story. And he says, so the door flies open and this little black boy with his big instrument comes walking through the door. And everybody laughed. They snigger to themselves. And they were, of course, expecting the worst. And he said, you know, and then this kid started playing. And he says, they never heard anything like it. Everybody went very quiet. But again, you know, you're right. There's the ridicule for the little man with the large wardrobe.
Yes, I don't think you'll ever escape it, but that's a touching tale. And music has the capacity to speak through circumstances where people are facing hardship. I think it's very important in this time in particular. And I wish that we had more time to speak about the cheapening of music in the modern day and age. I'm definitely going to have you back on so that we can touch on that.
Sure.
But the final one was a nice cello or nice guitar.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Again, you know, it says something about our education system. It says something about people's perceptions. And, you know, it's important, isn't it? Even in a country like the United Kingdom, which you would have thought would be a little bit more erudite, those kind of questions are very common also.
I'm sure they are.
You know, just to add a little thing, not that long ago, they did a survey in the United Kingdom about classical music. And I forget the exact percentage, and you could probably look it up. I think it was in the Daily Telegraph. Something like 60% or more of the population had never heard the name Beethoven.
I can't believe it.
Exactly.
I mean, of all composers not to know, how can that be the case? I mean, we really are just going into a steep decline at this point. It's mind-blowing. Well, Leon, our time has come to an end, as much as that pains me to say, but I'd like you to leave our listeners with some advice during the difficult times that we're facing at the moment as musicians. What would be your advice to them on how they can keep their career going?
Well, for musicians, I mean, I think the answer is probably even more straightforward than it is for some of the general population. The first thing to say is that when all of us started playing musical instruments, we were not motivated by anything other than just the desire to wish to play the instrument as well as we possibly could. We had a dream. It was to play music. Don't lose sight of your dreams. The dream will always propel you to a better place. It will always deliver. Don't make calculations which are short-term. Devote yourself entirely and completely and utterly to that dream. Everybody knows that the most successful people that have lived through history had one thing in common. It was their commitment to a dream.
Well, I think that is, as you said, something that a lot of people have lost in this day and age, and it's something that certainly keeps me going, and I hope that that brings people some comfort and just knowing that there is a way to achieve everything that you want to if you only set your heart on it and you don't focus on the wrong things and you don't let yourself become distracted or let down. You, if anyone, are a testament to that in what you've achieved in your life. And I can't thank you enough on the topic of thanking people. I can't thank you enough for having this chat with me. And I hope that we can speak again sometime, as there's still lots more that I'd like to ask you and pick your brain on.
Liam, it was a pleasure. You know, sometimes I feel that conversations raise so many interesting points and each point needs to be examined. And maybe in the future we'll have the opportunity to take one thing at a time and take it apart.